Well, this time we're going to transition to a really important talk, and I've been looking forward to this since we began planning the conference because Robin Perry was the first speaker that we asked to come. And Robin is the husband of Carol and the father of what he calls the two most beautiful girls in the universe, Hannah and Jessica. And he also has a lovely cat named Monty, who only has three legs. So he lives in a city in the UK that an average ignorant American from the Southwest would call Worcester, but someone who looked up it on the internet and knows how to pronounce it now would say Worcester.
Yes.
He works as an editor at Wipfenstock, which is a theological publisher of many fine books, and he's a prolific author in we could spend a few minutes recounting all the books, but two just to point out. One, Worshiping Trinity, which actually is a book that I bought for the church staff from my church. And then another book that he wrote, The Evangelical Universalist, which I did not buy copies of for the elders at my church, but I hope that they would read it someday, just not giving it for me. But he's written this book that has just been an amazing influence, and a lot of people have been reading it. And so we are so grateful to have Robin here with us. So please join me in welcoming Robin Perry.
Okay. When? What time do we finish again? All right. Okay. Shall we pray? Sorry, I'm not looking at my phone to take a selfie. It's because it's got to it has to scan my face to be able to open up. Let's pray. Christ as a light, illumine and guide us. Christ as a shield, overshadow us. Christ under us, Christ over us. Christ beside us on our left and our right. This day be within and without us, lowly and meek yet all-powerful. Be in the heart of each to whom we speak, and in the mouth of each who speaks unto us. This day be within and without me, lowly and meek yet all-powerful. Christ as a light, Christ as a shield, Christ beside me on my left and my right. Amen. Well, it's a great privilege to be here, and I would like to start just by honouring the Rethinking Hell folk who had the generosity and courage to invite people who had very different views from them along. And I'd also like to take the opportunity to thank and honour Edward Fudge and those like him who had such an influence on my life. In the 1980s, when I was an undergraduate, I was saying to someone yesterday, I used to go for lunch quite often with John Wenham. He was just a delightful man. And we would talk often about hell. And this was back in the day when, before Paternoster did a second edition of Fudge's thing, and this was contraband literature. And so he sort of passed me this book in a brown paper bag. The Fire That Consumes, and it was just liberating and transforming, and I still think is the best case for conditionalism. So I would just like to honour Edward. He was just, and when I met him for the first time, he was so much nicer than I could have even imagined, so that was great. Right. So, one of the fascinating things about the history of Universalism in the post-Reformation period is that the doctrine seems to be rediscovered over and over again. And while we can trace Universalist genealogies in the post-Reformation period, the more interesting feature is just how many folk seem to rediscover it for themselves from scratch without having had it passed on to them by anyone. So some folk have religious experiences which lead them to embrace Universalism. Others, through reading scriptures, come to discover it for themselves, and yet others, while wrestling with tensions in Christian theology and doctrine, find themselves drawn to the larger hope. But from the 17th century onwards, we find in Protestant countries Universalism breaking out over and over again, here and there and everywhere. And when one genealogical line dies off, as they often do, another one will spring up, often unconnected to any earlier movements. So the question I asked myself was, why? Sorry, these glasses are useless. The thing's too far away for me to focus anyway. Why is this? My conviction is that part of the answer to this question lies in the claim that universalism feels like a better fit within Christian theology than the alternatives, at least at face value. And as such, there's an internal pressure generated by various Christian doctrines that push in universalist directions. The doctrine of hell puts a blocker on those pushes, but in doing so, it generates this build-up of unresolved theological pressure that sometimes needs to be released. And one of the ways it can be released is by pushing eternalist interpretations of hell out, like a cork from a champagne bottle. So I think that even if every Christian universalist vanished into thin air and all the books they'd ever published disappeared right now, it wouldn't be too long until some other Christian rediscovered it for themselves again. Think of Christian theology. Oh, how do I work this thing, by the way? Just press the button like that. Oh, right. Okay. So think of Christian theology like an incomplete jigsaw. How do we know which pieces fit the gaps and which don't? The clues are provided by the shape of the pieces that are already there, the shape of the gap, the shape of the extra, and the pictures on the thing. My suggestion is that there isn't an obvious hell-shaped hole in the puzzle. Hell, understood as one's eternal fate, has been squashed and squeezed into a space in the jigsaw, but the shape and the picture on the piece isn't quite right. The space clearly has something to do with judgment, punishment, so the hell piece isn't totally out of place, and yet there's something wrong with it, and this creates a sort of niggling sense of dissatisfaction. And that this is the case is indicated not simply by people like me who have eventually chucked out the hell piece and replaced it with something we think fits better, but by the people who think that the hell piece should go there, and they go, yeah, of course, it doesn't look like it should, but they spend enormous amount of time trying to explain how, in fact, things are not how they seem, and it really does fit. Now, the salvation story that the church tells seems to me to generate, by its own internal narrative logic, certain expectations about the appropriate end to the plot. And while we may well expect that the journey towards the end will involve judgment and punishment, the narrative logic, I suggest, does not lead us to expect it to end in eternal damnation for some, or many, or most people, delete as appropriate. Eternal damnation sounds more like the unexpected twist at the end of a Hammer horror film, or to use a musical analogy, it's a bit like a discordant note sounded at the end of a Mozart symphony. Instinctively, or at a gut level, we feel that it doesn't quite fit, and indeed is rather ugly. The universalist proposal is that, in fact, it doesn't fit, that the Bible doesn't actually teach such a doctrine, that many in the early church never accepted such a doctrine, and that we'd be better off throwing out the rogue jigsaw piece and replacing it with one that fits the gap better, both in terms of the shape and the picture. Universalists also worry that by insisting on retaining the hell piece, this does damage to the rest of the jigsaw, but because by forcing the piece into the place, we sort of squash the other bits around to fit it, and then maybe even do a little bit of repainting of the picture on them so that the hell piece doesn't look so inappropriate or out of place. To drop the barrage of analogies, jigsaws, movies, symphonies and stories, what I'm saying is that the doctrine of hell may lead us to reconfigure other parts of Orthodox theology in order to relieve the pressure. Perhaps we might say God didn't create everyone for beatific union with God. Perhaps some of them were created with eternal destinies for damnation. Perhaps Jesus doesn't represent all humanity, but a subset of it, and perhaps he didn't die for everyone, but just for some of them or someone. And these ideas do serve to relieve some of the pressure on hell, but they do so at a cost. A cost in all sorts of areas, such at face value, for example, such notions don't appear to be biblical, I would think, and they are theologically problematic, arguably not true to the pre-Augustinian Christian tradition either. What we need to remember is that when we speak about hell, we're never simply speaking about hell. We are also implicitly speaking about creation and about humanity and about sin, justice, punishment, atonement, about God. Every hellology implies a theology, and every doctrine of eschatological punishment implies a doctrine of God. When considering which account of divine judgment to embrace, we are always doing more than simply exegeting this passage or that passage of the Bible. We're also always looking at the big picture, at least if we're reading scripture theologically. We need to remember that for Christians, biblical texts are only authoritative when they are read within the context of the canon of scripture and in the light of the rule of faith. So an atomistic approach to the topic that builds everything on the interpretation of a handful of passages is never going to do. These passages will importantly factor into Christian reflection, but only as located within a bigger context. So today, what I want to do is briefly sketch out the narrative logic of the biblical plotline, as I see it, so as to make clearer the jigsaw pattern, back to the metaphors now, that I think the doctrine of final judgment has to fit comfortably within. A couple of caveats. For reasons of time, I don't have time to talk about one very important part of the plot, which is God's way with Israel. It's not that I think that's dispensable with. I don't. It's just we would open up too many issues to deal with in the time, so I'm going to skip that. And also, another caveat, I'm not going to be looking at any particular hell texts. I mean, you're welcome to ask me about them later, but again, we don't have time. So my goal is a bit more modest. I'm hoping to offer something like the initial stages of a prolegomena to the theological interpretation of the appropriation of texts like those. So, hell in the context of the biblical narrative. Exitus et Reditus. The first part of the material that follows can be found, it's a modified version of a section in a book that Jerry and I are involved with, a Zondervan Four Views on Hell book that's going to be coming out at some point. So some of this next section comes from that. So this is like an ad for the book. I'm just saying that to keep Zondervan happy in case they think I'm nicking material that they've got the copyright to. Right. Everything starts and ends with God. Paul writes that creation is from God and through God and to God, Romans 11. God is the context of the world, the origin and destiny of creation. That is the basic pattern that forms Christian theology. Exitus et Reditus, going forth from God and returning to God. It forms a very broad theological framework in which I'm going to operate. So consider, as I did at the beginning of the Evangelical Universalist, the Christ hymn in Colossians 1. For in him, that is in Christ, all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authority, all things have been created through him and for him. God was pleased through him to reconcile all things to himself, whether things on earth or in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. So what we have here is a story that begins with the creation of all things through Christ and runs to the reconciliation of the same all things through Christ. That is to say, all things that have been created. Exitus et Reditus. Avoiding the universalism in this text remains a significant challenge for those who believe in eternal hell. Eternal hell, after all, doesn't seem much like reconciliation. But I'll say no more about that for now. So I propose that we explore the Christ-centered creation to new creation plotline as the context within which we consider hell. And this hermeneutical judgment underpins my entire approach. And already we might catch a glimpse of a possible red flag. Might an eternal hell foul up the Reditus of creation? How can creation return to God if it doesn't actually ever return to God? Creation. All things are from him and for him. All Christians are universalists about creation. God created all things through his word. And creation is not simply about origins, that everything comes from God, but it's about purpose and destiny. Created things have an end, and that end, as the beginning, is God. The end of creation is there in its beginning. Creation is from God, for God, and orientated towards God. Reaching its point, reaching its potential and completion in God. So the question of universalism and hell can be framed in terms of whether or not God will bring all creation to the goal for which he intended it. Yes or no? Let's get more specific. Take humans, the subject of this debate. Christians agree that all humans are created in the image of God. But while God did create humans as good, he did not create humans as finished and as completed creatures. He created them with a destiny to grow towards. This destiny or telos of human creatures is, in community, to be filled with God and to image God in the world. Furthermore, humans find their sense of fulfillment and happiness in God. We all long for happiness. As Jerry Walls puts it, we have a built-in hard drive to desire happiness. That's how God made us. And this desire cannot be fulfilled outside of God. Augustine famously puts it, "Our hearts are restless until they find rest in you." So our story of creation already includes a notion of the goal for which God created humans. And, newsflash, that goal is not everlasting alienation from God. The gospel revelation of Jesus Christ deepens and sharpens our understanding of the human telos. The risen and ascended humanity of Christ is the climax of our human nature. One day we shall be like him. For us, being human is a yet-to-be-completed journey. Jesus is the only person of whom it can be said that he is fully human. Humanity has reached its goal in him. And in the gospel, it becomes clearer to us that the creation of humanity was always a two-phase project. The first Adam was earthly, the second Adam heavenly. Humanity was made with a destiny to be conformed to the image of the true human, the origin of the new phase two humanity, Jesus Christ. This theology is foundational for universalism. Humans are being created to grow towards God as their destination. They are not created for hell, but for theosis. The fall. Genesis suggests that the move from phase one to phase two humanity was interrupted by sin. Sin is the creature's attempt to interrupt the reditus, the return to God, which is the goal of creation. And as such, sin represents a rupture in creation. It corrodes human being at every level and makes it impossible for us to reach that destination. Instead, we spiral away from God, the source of life, into corruption, decay, and death. And all Christians are universalists about sin. All have sinned, fallen short of the glory of God. Without divine redemptive grace, human beings and creation as a whole are doomed to futility. Might hell be able to build on the foundation of this plot twist? Well, without divine redemptive grace, human beings... Oh, I just said that bit. Do we deserve divine punishment? Yes, we do. And do we deserve divine rescue? No, we don't. But remember, every broken human is still in God's image, still valuable and still beloved. Here is a quote from John Cronin and Eric Reitan. All creatures participate in God's goodness, especially rational creatures who are made in God's image. The rational creature is essentially a being bearing the divine image and ordered towards union with God. God can no more cease to value rational creatures, even if they fall into sin, than he can cease to value himself, because rational creatures are a reflection of his own essence. Therefore, he is always faithful to them, even when they are unfaithful to him, and he must seek to destroy their sin. To hate creatures made in his own image, even fallen ones, would be a form of indirect self-hatred, and this God cannot do. Thus, Jürgen Moltmann, God is angered by human sin, not although he loves human beings, but because he loves them. He says no to sin because he says yes to the sinner. Anthony Bloom, a former Metropolitan Bishop of the Russian Orthodox Church in Great Britain, once said, "Every one of us is in the image of God, and every one of us is like a damaged icon. But if we were given an icon damaged by time, damaged by circumstances, or desecrated by human hatred, we would treat it with reverence, with tenderness, with broken-heartedness. We would not pay attention primarily to the fact that it's damaged, but to the tragedy of its being damaged. We would concentrate on what is left of its beauty, and not on what is lost of its beauty. We must learn to look and look until we see the underlying beauty. Only then can we even begin to do something to call out the beauty that is still there. Blogger Alvin Rapier, commenting on this quote in his discussion of annihilationism, writes, "If human beings are like damaged icons, and annihilationists hold that God completely annihilates human beings through the fires of hell, then the doctrine of annihilationism makes God the great iconoclast, the destroyer of human icons. God would be destroying the very creation meant for communion, repeating the actions of the iconoclasts that were condemned in the Seventh Ecumenical Council. Instead of treating these icons with tenderness, with brokenheartedness, and calling out the beauty that is there, as Bloom stated, annihilationism holds that God inflicts capital punishment upon these images, that the fires of hell will consume them, similar to how the iconoclast extremists tore down icons from their places in churches and broke them up and burnt them. The God of annihilationism is the God of the iconoclasts, the ultimate destroyer of God's images." That's a quote, so he said that, and it was a bit bad. It's just a thought to consider. So, building a doctrine of hell on the doctrine of the fall, my point is, it might prove a bit harder than we think at first. Hell's defenders should try to do so, but they will have to wrestle with the wider biblical meta-narrative in which the fall is located. And the question is, will God allow sin to thwart his creational purposes for the cosmos? The answer comes, as we'll see, in the gospel story. Sin can be as deep and dark and deadly as it likes, but Christ annihilates it. The first Adam may have wrought havoc, but the second Adam more than undoes that destruction. And where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. One problem with hell is that it makes the victory of Christ over sin sound something of a damp squib. Sin wreaks havoc in creation, but praise be, grace undoes a little bit of it. Where sin abounds, grace abounds quite a lot. Is that divine victory over sin? Because it looks at first blush like the doctrine of hell is a doctrine in which Satan receives a big chunk of what he set out to do. And if the Augustinian tradition is correct and most people are forever damned, then eschatological victory is in danger of something like sounding like a celebration after hearing the following soccer score. Satan 5, God 1. Hooray, God's won. For Augustine, this score does in fact count as a win, because God wanted Satan to score 5, and he only wanted one goal for himself. And he plans on beating up Satan after the match. But it still sounds to me just like another way of trying to say that God lost. Redemption, all things are through him. First of all, incarnation. The divine word, the second person of the Holy Trinity, became flesh. As the second Adam, Jesus represents the whole human race. He is the sinless and obedient one in whom God's covenant relationship with humanity finds fulfillment. Most Christians have been universalists about Christ's humanity. He represents all humans in his humanity. Here, for instance, is Hilary of Poitiers. Apologies to all French people who can say these things properly. Christ has become the body of the whole of humanity, that through the body that he was kind enough to assume, the whole of humanity might be hidden in him. Christ's being fully human is fundamental for our salvation. As Gregory of Nazianzus famously said, that which he has not assumed, he is not healed. He became human so that he could heal humanity in himself, in his humanity, through his death and resurrection. And this is suggestive. Listen to Athanasius. Flesh was taken up by the Logos to liberate all humans and resurrect all of them from the dead and ransom all of them from sin. The death of Christ. Most Christians, past and present, have been universalists about the death of Christ. He died for all people in order to save all people. This belief is well grounded in scripture and tradition. Consider the following well-known verse. Christ is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for our sins, but also for the sins of the whole world. 1 John 2. And recall that in 1 John, as in John's Gospel, the world is the God-rejecting sinful world. So we know who God loved so much that he sent his only Son. It was the world. He didn't send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Now, I'm well aware of a post-Reformation minority report of limited atonement, and I don't have time to get into that. The mainstream historic Christian tradition is clear enough and is well summed up by Athanasius. Christ delivered his own body to death on behalf of all in order to bring again to incorruptibility the human beings now doomed to corruption. Exitus et Reditus. This teaching emphasizes the mainstream Christian view that God desires the redemption of all people and has acted in Christ in order to bring this about. Now, while I don't have much sympathy with limited atonement, I do see that behind it lies a serious theological worry that I do have sympathy with. And the worry is this: will the cross save all those for whom Christ died, or will his death have been in vain for some of them? The five-point Calvinist finds the idea that Christ died for many, or any people, in vain to be deeply problematic. And so do I. But because I think that some folk, because some people are going to go to hell forever, it can't be the case. So they sort of infer from that, they deduce that Christ couldn't have died for those people. It wouldn't make sense. But couldn't we work it the other way around? You know, he died for all people, so they're all going to be saved. Of course, that's the right answer, by the way. Oh, sorry. Go back. Does that work? Yes, it does. Resurrection and ascension. The resurrection of Jesus is new creation. It is the age to come breaking into the evil age of the present. Jesus' resurrection is not simply Jesus' resurrection. It is ours. It is the destiny of humanity played out in the person of our representative. All Christian eschatology must be Christ-centered, and it must be grounded here in this event. Because here we see the future of the world and the future of humanity manifest in the risen flesh of the Lord. The story of humanity does not terminate on a cross, but passes through a tomb and ascends to God. Christ, says Paul, was raised for our justification. And indeed, his resurrection is our justification. That is why I think Paul can be so confident that just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, Adam, the many were made sinners, so through the obedience of the one man, Christ, the many will be made righteous. Many Christians think or feel that a confident universalism is presumptuous, for we cannot claim to know the end. And while there is a lot that we do not know about the end, we do know this: Christ is risen. And that's enough. Because God has revealed the destiny of humanity right here. And for me, that's what it means, more than anything, to be an evangelical universalist. It means to found one's universalism in the evangel. And to be confident in my universalism, I would say, is not presumptuous, because I'm not claiming anything more than that in Christ, humanity rises again and returns to God. The church, a foretaste of the age to come. We live in a time now between the resurrection of Jesus and the general resurrection of the dead, between the inauguration of the kingdom of God and our full participation in it. So the new age is here now, for Christ has risen and been exalted, and the Spirit has been poured out, and yet we still await his complete arrival. That tension, as you all know, permeates the New Testament. And it permeates discussions of universal salvation in the New Testament. On the one hand, in the person of the risen Christ, everyone is already redeemed. God has already reconciled the world to himself in Christ. On the other hand, those who have been united to Christ by the Spirit now participate in this salvation, even if only in an anticipatory way, until the general resurrection. So the actual existential participation of all people in salvation is not a present reality, it lies in the future. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. So is everyone currently justified? Well, yes and no. In that Christ has been raised for our justification, we are already justified in his resurrection. However, it's only as we respond in obedient trust to the gospel and are united to Christ by the Spirit that we participate subjectively in this justification. So this now, not yet tension, you can see it throughout Paul's letters. An instance, 2 Corinthians 5. Paul addresses the issue of universal significance of Christ's work. We read that one died for all, therefore all died, and that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And from this perspective, there are no insiders or outsiders. Everyone's an insider. And yet, Paul still issues the imperative. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. A spirit-enabled human response to the gospel is still required if people are to share in the salvation already achieved in Christ. And right now, many live outside the gospel community. So Paul makes a very clear distinction in all his writings between those who are in Christ and those who are not, between the church and the world, between believers and unbelievers, between those who are elect and those who are not, the former being saved, the latter perishing. It's critical to note, however, that for Paul, the dead in sin can become those alive in Christ. Children destined for wrath can become children of mercy. This is relevant because we can't assume that just because Paul sees a current divide between those being saved and those perishing, that this divide will remain in place eternally. A point, I think, Romans 9 to 11 makes well. Consummation. All things are to him. Eschatology, says John A.T. Robinson, is an explication of what must be true of the end, both of history and of the individual, if God is to be the God of biblical faith. All eschatological statements can finally be reduced to, and their validity tested by, sentences beginning, in the end, God... I think that this insight is profoundly important. For God to be the God revealed in Jesus Christ, the God of the gospel, our eschatology must be gospel-shaped. And what does that look like? The answer, I suggest, is that it looks like the risen Lord. The gospel gets to call the shots. The gospel gets to determine the shape of the end. This sounds very much like a story for which universal salvation is a fitting ending. Thus, Paul speaks of the mystery of God's will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to put into effect when all times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. All creation is made for and orientated to God, is summed up and brought to its fitting conclusion and destiny in Jesus. Then at Jesus' name, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, which is to say the dead, and every tongue will confess him as Lord. All will be subject to Christ. Christ will subject himself to the Father on behalf of the cosmos and creation. And then God will be all, and God will be in all. And that's the kind of ending I would expect for the biblical story. We're so used to the traditional story of hell as the final fate of some or many or most people that we usually fail to notice how out of place it feels as a conclusion to this story. But surely we need a very good explanation for a tale, this tale, ending in tragedy for some or many or most people. What possible reasons could there be for such an unexpected climax? So, let's have a look at everlasting hell, the troublesome piece of the jigsaw, which is the second thing of what I wanted to say. The victory of divine love over evil. Doctrines of hell, both in the Augustinian and free will versions, both their eternal torment and their annihilationist versions, have more problems than a hedgehog has spikes. And it's hard to know how best to handle the issue in so short a time. That's going to be my excuse for everything. You're going to hear me go a lot, I don't have time to deal with that, which means I don't really know what the answer is, but don't ask me, please. So I thought I'd use the rethinking hell triangle as a way into it. as a way to get, and particularly the way it deals with evil, which I will actually be slightly modifying from on the thing there. First, a word about the ontology of evil, and here one of my part-time heroes, Augustine, offers some helpful insight. He argues that all created things come from the goodness of the Creator and are good. So evil is not a substance, it's not a thing, it's not a stuff, you can't pick up a lump of evil or something. Evil is the absence of good, is parasitic upon the good. Here is a quote from the Enchiridion. In the bodies of animals, disease and wounds means nothing but the absence of health. For when a cure is effected, that doesn't mean that the evils which were present, namely the disease and the wounds, go away from the body and dwell elsewhere. They altogether cease to exist. For the wound or disease is not a substance, but a defect in the fleshly substance, the flesh itself being a substance and therefore something good, of which those evils, that is, privations of the good which we call health, are accidents. Just in the same way, what are called vices in the soul are nothing but privations or lacks in natural good. And when they are cured, they're not transferred elsewhere. When they cease to exist in a healthy body, in a healthy soul, they cannot exist anywhere else. The ontology of evil that Augustine articulates here was, in fact, widely shared Christian view by his day. Christian Platonist tradition prior to Augustine held firmly to the notion that evil was not ontologically essential to creation and that God would defeat it. But defeat it how? There are two options that have been considered by Christians. You can either imprison it, evil, this is, or you can annihilate it. And there are two very different ways that you can annihilate it. You can either annihilate the substance that has been corrupted by evil, or you can heal the substance that's been corrupted by evil and thereby eradicate the evil. This yields the three basic options of the hell triangle, which I will describe as the prison, the guillotine, and the hospital. The prison forever balances evil with perfectly proportioned retributive justice. The guillotine annihilates evil by annihilating those affected with it. And the hospital annihilates evil, doesn't convert it, it annihilates it. That's where I'm nuancing the diagram. By healing those afflicted with it. Or as we better know them, eternal torment, annihilationism, and universalism. And I should add here that what I'm about to say doesn't quite apply to Jerry Walls' version, which is its own hybrid thing, and I haven't got time to do justice to it. So if Jerry thinks, but that doesn't apply to me, well, you're right, it doesn't. But some of it does. The prison and the guillotine, did I? Right. Augustine believed that everlasting damnation is the clear teaching of divine revelation given in Scripture. And so he felt obliged to fit it into the jigsaw, and I am not objecting to his attempt to do so, given his convictions regarding the teaching of Scripture. In fact, it was perfectly appropriate that he should. My point is going to simply be that he didn't do it very well, and that propels us to ask again whether he had interpreted Scripture aright on this issue. So what's the problem? In the first instance, it's this. Those in hell are sinners, humans with broken and defective souls. But with Augustine's hell, God keeps such sinners in existence as sinners for eternity. God actively perpetuates the existence of sinfulness and evil in his creation, world without end. Now, Augustine believes that those in hell don't continue to perform active sins, sinful acts, because their power for sinning has been removed. Nevertheless, they remain sinful because their souls have sinful and disordered dispositions oriented away from God. If that wasn't so, they wouldn't be sinners, they would have been redeemed, and they wouldn't be in hell in the first place. So God maintains them in this condition. He doesn't allow their sin to corrode them into non-existence. He doesn't annihilate them. He doesn't redeem them. He just perpetuates them in this sinful and broken condition. And as such, Augustine's God would rather have a world in which sin and evil were forever perpetuated than one in which they were eradicated. It is somewhat ironic that the theologian who was so effective in critiquing Manichaean dualism of good and evil locked in an eternal conflict ended up crafting his own, albeit different, eternal dualism of good and evil. For Augustine, God purposed from before the foundation of the world that creation should forever fall short of its own telos. God intends that only some parts of creation will ever achieve the goal of eschatological completion. Why? Because hell is an everlasting public display of divine justice, and that, says Augustine, is a great good. A world in which sin exists forever and is perfectly balanced by retributive punishment is a better world than one in which there is no permanent sin and no permanent display of divine punishment. I'm reminded here of Jonathan Edwards's claim, reflecting something of his panentheism, that the reprobate suffering in hell form a part of the infinite complex beauty of God's being. And such a complex beauty, said Edwards, requires irregularities and deformities. These are his words, not mine. And the damned, said Edwards, are these deformities in God. Strong words for a perfect being theologian like Edwards. And they ought to have caused him some sleepless nights, or at least some dreams about red flags. John Bambaro comments on Edwards, God is simple because his ideal essence of an infinitely complex beauty is perfectly and totally integrated into all that God is and does. For this reason, Edwards admits of no distress with God purposely orchestrating the fall, decreeing sin and evil, facilitating pain, suffering and damnation. The tormented damned are part of God's beauty. That's a ballsy move. And we don't have time to pick apart all the problems hanging out in the bars near this proposal. But let me suggest that we should at least find it an odd and unexpected ending to the plot we traced earlier. The jigsaw piece certainly doesn't seem like a comfortable fit. To make it fit better, Augustine and Edwards worked hard at modifying the other parts of the jigsaw, but this has the awkward feel of what Barth calls God behind the back of Jesus Christ, a secret God hidden behind the one revealed in the incarnation, a God whose secret will differs from the revealed will of God. Red flags? Augustine claims that his theology has a friend in divine justice, but I would beg to differ. I have a serious problem with the claim that everlasting hell is a display of justice. I think that Augustine is too seeped in Roman understandings of justice that he hasn't appreciated that biblical understandings are much wider and go beyond mere retribution, although they do include retribution. So I don't think that everlasting hell is a display of biblical justice. In addition, I don't think it's even a simple display of retributive justice. Augustine's own defense of the eternal nature, why does hell have to last forever, is hopelessly inadequate. And I also think that Anselm's very different and later attempt to justify that was also inadequate. Others beg to differ. Well, that's a discussion for another time. If Augustine really wanted retributive justice, he'd have been better off being an annihilationist. And he would have had the added benefit that he could have eradicated evil from creation had he gone that route. So divine justice, the one theological friend that Augustine's view of hell had to play with, and it turns out that even that friend has turned its back on him. Now, Augustine has another problem. His view of hell threatens the revelation of God's love, and the thinking is simple enough. If God is love, then God's disposition towards the other, his creation, is loving. To love someone is to desire what is best for them. So if God is love, God desires what is best for his creatures. And what is that? Union with Christ in God. Or union with God in Christ. Now I believe that the instincts behind this argument are entirely biblical. But again, argument for another day. For Augustine, loving creation is entirely optional for God. God could, if he wanted to, love and redeem all his creatures. Augustine says that, but he doesn't want to. He doesn't have to. He could show love and compassion, but he decides not to. Hell, for Augustine, has nothing to do with God's love, for God doesn't love the reprobate. Hell only displays God's love for the elect, because it gives them a vivid display of what they deserved, so that they will better appreciate and enjoy their life in heaven. Now, Augustine would never deny that God is love. In fact, his doctrine of the Trinity is deeply rooted in the notion of God's inner divine love. But I would argue that if Augustine is right on hell, then God is not love in his very essence. And that is a problem, a big red flag. And it's a problem because it arguably messes up Augustine's own Trinitarian theology. And it's a problem because Augustine's God ceases to be what Anselm called that than which nothing greater can be conceived. Because even I can conceive of a greater God than that of Augustine's scheme, which is to say, a God who is love. And to be frank, I don't want to risk screwing up my doctrine of God just so I can hold on to a doctrine of hell. Certainly not if there is a better alternative on the table. Perhaps Augustine should have reconsidered his biblical arguments for everlasting hell, which aren't bad. I mean, they're not rubbish arguments, but they're not that amazing, especially given the heavy theological burden he wants to place on their back. So, in sum, Augustine's view is at best a hard sell, and it deserves to be greeted at least with raised eyebrows. It's like dressing a dog turd in a bikini and entering it for a beauty contest. Of course, Augustine's problems are compounded by his predestinarianism. Believers in eternal torment do not have to be Augustinians in this respect. The more common approach among apologists for hell nowadays is to argue that God desires to save all people, but that he allows his creatures the dignity of freedom to choose whether or not to embrace that blessed destiny. Those who reject God will find that hell, whether eternal torment or annihilation, is the end that they have chosen. Now, I do think that God's love is protected on this view, and I also think that this view has many able defenders. I don't, as you know, think it works. I would side with Tom Talbot, John Cronin, Eric Reitan on that. But again, that's another issue. What I want to focus on is, let's assume that that approach does work. What are the costs of it? There is a cost. If eschatological destruction is something that God reluctantly allows his creatures to inflict upon themselves, then it represents God's permanent failure to bring about his purposes in the case of all such creatures. And remember that for some folk, that includes most human beings who've ever lived. He tried to stop them before it was too late, but they just slipped through his fingers like sand and were gone. But if, on the other hand, it's something that God actively inflicts on his sinful creatures, then it represents God's permanent abandoning of his purposes in the case of all such creatures. He tried to woo them over, but they thwarted his attempt, so he gave up trying and condemned them to hell or blasted them out of existence. And remember that if this life is the only opportunity we have for salvation, most of those who are eternally obliterated are people who would likely have chosen God given more time or better circumstances, what Jerry Walls calls optimal grace. God seems to give up on them rather easily. Either way, God has failed to bring a significant part of his creation to the destination for which he intended it. Instead, he reluctantly settles for second best, whether that be the prison or the guillotine. Because on this view, that's not what God desires. He doesn't desire the prison or the guillotine, but he accepts it as a cost. Of course, believers in free will, hell, would never put it in that way. But in the cold light of day, it's hard for me to see it otherwise. And I do find this to be terribly problematic as a theological position. Maybe it's my inner Calvinist rising up. I appreciate that some are prepared to bite the bullet on this, but I am a classical theist, and it is inconceivable to me that God could so catastrophically fail. Indeed, it seems to me to be something akin to Orwellian doublespeak to call the end of this narrative God's triumph over sin or divine victory. The problem is that this notion of divine victory is theoretically compatible with a state in which every rational agent freely chooses to reject God and embrace extinction. We would look at the eschatological state in which the whole cosmos was burning in hell or had been annihilated, and in which none of those for whom Christ had died were saved, and none of the creatures he created had reached the goal for which he created it, and we would say, this is God's triumph over sin. But for all the world, it looks to me like the triumph of sin and Satan over God's purposes. And it makes God wins worryingly close in meaning to God loses. In my view, annihilationists rightly raise the objection against eternal torment that on a traditional view, evil is never removed from creation, but is simply constrained, contained in an everlasting stasis chamber. Indeed, better to be done with sin and banish it from creation. Annihilation removes the problem of the guillotine. There are no sinners in the new creation, and God is all in all. But the problem to me on this view is that God's answer to evil here seems not to be a gospel solution. The gospel is about death and resurrection. It's about transformation of sinners. This is a terminator solution. You eradicate the sinners themselves. And it's a drastic way of winning creation. It's like winning all the votes in an election, but only by killing off everyone who would have voted differently. Hypothetically, God could annihilate the vast majority of human beings and then have claimed to have won a glorious victory in a universe filled with creatures that love him. But such a victory may well seem a Pyrrhic victory, because the cost of winning is so very, very high. And given that this is a cost that God really didn't want to pay, on the free will view, then it's as much a failure for God as a victory. It looks to me like on this view, sin and death have their wicked way in the end, forcing God to abandon and obliterate many of those whom he loves. Here is Nick Ansell. It's worth reminding ourselves that the annihilation and destruction of God's good creation is precisely the aim and goal of evil, not evidence of its defeat. The destruction, indeed the self-destruction of those made in God's image, represents a victory for the forces of darkness. In the transformation of everlasting punishment into final annihilation, evil still has the last word. It seems to me that hell, as eternal torment or annihilation, as prison or guillotine, is in danger of either losing God's love in its Augustinian modes or God's victory over sin in its free will modes. And it's a hard jigsaw piece to fit. And both options seem to be unnecessarily drastic given that there is an alternative. The hospital. The alternative tradition, which predates Augustine, is that God annihilates evil, and this, I'm nearly finished, honest. is that God annihilates evil by restoring the universe to himself and thereby healing it. And the restoration of creation is the destruction of evil, for evil has no substantial reality. So this is Gregory of Nyssa. Evil must necessarily be eliminated, absolutely and in every respect, once and for all, from all that is. And since, in fact, it is not, that is to say, it has no being in itself, neither will it have to exist at all. For as evil does not exist in its nature outside of will, once each will has come to be in God, evil will be reduced to complete disappearance, because no receptacle for it will be left. It seems to me, Scripture teaches the complete disappearance of evil, for if all beings will be in God, clearly in them, there will be no evil. And God will not obliterate the good substantial beings he has made. This is Al Walters, who's not a universalist, by the way, but he's a nice guy. Even some non-universalists are nice. God does not create trash, and he does not trash what he creates. Commenting on Psalm 59:6 and 14, Gregory writes, "There will be no destruction of humans that the work of God may not be emptied by annihilation. Instead of human creatures, what will be destroyed and reduced to non-being will be sin." In a similar vein, Athanasius writes, "Christ, because he is good and loves humanity, came to bring fire onto the earth. He wanted the repentance and conversion of all human beings rather than its death. And in this way, evilness, all of it, will be burnt away from human beings. Exitus et Reditus." I ought to flag up at this point that all analogies have limitations and problems, and in this context, the hospital analogy fails to do justice to the critical notions of human responsibility for evil and divine judgment on evil. So I'm not trying to be comprehensive here and say everything we need to say about God's response to evil. I'm simply trying to indicate the manner in which evil is finally annihilated, namely by eradicating it from humans. And in that respect, I think the hospital analogy works, but I'd be a bit cautious and want to supplement it with some other things as well. This is a theological framework, then, in conclusion, that I think eschatological punishment was interpreted by many of the fathers. Consequently, hell was understood as a means to a salvific end and not the everlasting fate of anyone. Such fathers had no qualms about affirming the biblical teaching on everlasting final punishment, and they didn't shrink from the biblical imagery, and they didn't shrink from the biblical language. But such imagery and such language were understood within a wider theological framework. The flames of hell were understood as the flames of justice, of course, but simultaneously as the flames of divine love. Hell was God's burning love. St. Isaac of Nineveh puts this rather well. If we said or thought that what concerns Gehenna is not in fact full of love and mixed with compassion, this would be an opinion full of blasphemy and against God our Lord. Among all his deeds, there is none that is not entirely dictated by mercy, love, and compassion. This is the beginning and the end of God's attitude towards us. Or as someone else said, love wins.
So, as you were listening to Robin's presentation, you may have had a certain kind of experience. You may have found your heart strangely warmed, and you wondered, "What if he's right?" Don't be scared of that. You're showing intellectual humility there. You're saying, "I might be wrong." You're showing open-mindedness. What does this person have to say? I want to listen to this. Those are good virtues to practice. And I would also ask you to practice some other virtues: thoroughness, patience. You know, don't just say, "Well, he solved it, I'm going to order his book, I'll see you guys later." We need to keep thinking. We'll have opportunities to hear from some other perspectives. You also might have been listening and thinking, "This is completely wrong," and you're getting on Amazon to order the tar and feathers for Robin. And I would ask you to exercise some virtue as well. You don't need to prove Robin wrong right now. We'll have opportunities to hear from other speakers this today and tomorrow. But it would be great to ask Robin some clarifying questions or try to understand his view better, as well as if you feel the need to respond in some way. So let me give the microphone.
That's fantastic. What I imagine you've had questions about determinism with this, the charge that universalism implies a determinism. What's your best response to that? Do you just not worry about it, or what do you thought?
Okay, it's such a huge issue. How best to, my quick best response, if you really want to know the answer to that, you talk to Eric. Eric Reitan over there, who's the guy on free will and universalism, along with Tom Talbot and John Cronin. So he's the guy that could answer this question better than me. I would say, just very briefly, oh, crumbs, it's such a big question.
Sorry, man.
Okay, so there's different ways of understanding human freedom and what that is. And one of those ways is compatibilism, which says that although all our human actions are actually determined, which is to say, given the same initial conditions, well, they will. It's 100% predictable. Of course, if you knew everything about the situation in which someone made the choice, which you never do, knew all the factors and forces involved, you could know exactly what they would choose. God, of course, knows exactly what we'll do. Okay, forget the God bit. Too many caveats. And so, you know, in a sense, we could never choose to do other than what we do choose to do. It might feel like we could have chosen to do something other than pick these glasses up like now, but in fact, if I'd known everything about the situation in which I did it, I could never have not chosen to pick up the glasses to do it. However, a compatibilist would say, well, I'm still free to do that so long as I'm being allowed to do what I want to do, and there's not someone who ties my hands behind my back or something and stops me doing it, it's still a free choice, because even if I don't choose the desires that motivate me to pick up the glasses, I'm, you know. So if you are a determinist, of course, and you are a compatibilist, then of course there's no problem. God could bring it about that everybody freely chooses to embrace the gospel. And that is fine and straightforward. And many Calvinists, though not all, are compatibilists and determinists. It's more of a problem than, and it might be that a free will theist would go, well, in that case, you know, you have to take that view of freedom. If you take a view in which we have a libertarian freedom, a freedom in which we pick up the glasses, but it's only a free choice, not only if we're not constrained from doing it, you know, we're able to do it, no one's holding us back or whatever, but if we couldn't have ever done anything other than that, if it was never a genuine, real, metaphysical possibility that we could have picked the glasses up, or not picked the glasses up, I'm not being very clear, then we're not free. And of course, such a kind of freedom is not determined, right? And so God couldn't cause you to freely choose to do something, because then it's not free, and in that case, God can't guarantee that we're all going to choose the right thing, and much as he might try and lead us and woo us and do all sorts of things, he can't guarantee the end. That's just setting up the problem. The solution is long and complicated. Oh, Brad, why did you have to ask that question? I mean, so the conclusion, what I would argue is that, rightly construed, libertarian freedom also does not stop God being able to bring it about that all people freely accept the gospel in the end. Here, let me just say this. If you want to know why, read the book. I'll think of a shorter answer for later. Yeah.
During your lecture, you said that you can't conceive of God destroying his creatures within this narrative framework. And I want to ask, how do you conceive of the flood of Noah within that framework, where he did destroy people, not only as its own event, but as a type of the coming judgment?
Yeah, okay, it depends what you mean by destroy his creatures. Perhaps I wasn't clear enough. I do think God judges and kills people. And stuff like that. What I was suggesting was, I find it problematic that God would, what Tom Talbot says, inflict irredeemable harm on someone, something that could not, in the long run, be reversed and undone. So yes, God can do the flood and so on. It would be more of a problem if God eternally inflict. I mean, I remember thinking this years ago when I was thinking about, long before I was a universalist, and I was thinking about falsification, logical positivism, Anthony and A.J. Ayer, and verification and falsification. And one of the challenges was, what does it mean to say that God loves someone? You know, what kind of conditions would falsify that claim? Does the claim that God loves someone exclude any conditions? And if you can't say what kinds of situations are excluded by that claim, the claim becomes vacuous. It doesn't mean anything. Because a claim that is compatible with every state of affairs is empty. And I think that's quite a challenge, because once you start specifying conditions under which the claim that God loves people would be falsified, if those conditions came about, of course, then you falsified the claim, and you don't really want to make those kind of claims too vulnerable. And particularly when you're talking about God anyway, and we don't. Anyway, but if God, you know, if God inflicted eternal hell on someone, and, you know, that they never ever, that there was never ever any ultimate redemption, that things never got better, ever, 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 I thought, actually, I think that would probably provide me some good falsifying conditions for the claim that God is love. And then I thought, but that would be a problem, of course, because I believe that's exactly what is God going to do. So that doesn't answer your question either, does it? It's rambling. Oh, well, sorry. But the short answer is, I do think God can inflict destruction and death on people and so on. I just don't think God... It would be very problematic for me to say that God...
Only the temporal kind, not the eternal kind?
Yeah, that's it. Thanks. God, I wish you were here.
I'm here for you.
Yeah.
Thanks, Robin, for your... presentation. I was wondering if you could say more about your hermeneutic as far as not simply being exegesis, because although I didn't grow up an evangelical Christian. I grew up Jehovah's Witness, but when I converted, I was in a very conservative evangelical, kind of like a, you know, trumpet exegesis, right? And then having gone through the world a little bit, you realize that you exegesis is always a theological endeavor, that no one comes empty. And I think you were trying to get at that, but just for the sake of, I know, given the context of our meeting together, that there are probably others, and I'm probably not as articulate as you'd be able to be, to explain why can you never just have simply exegesis, but that when you exegete, you need to provide, like what you did, a kind of what David Kelsey has said in his proving doctrine, that you need to have like a theological discrimin, you're reading from a perspective always. You can never just have exegesis as primary. And so as Christians...
Yeah, right, good question. And I guess I go back, I remember as an undergrad, one of the texts we had to study was Anthony Thistleton's The Two Horizons, philosophical hermeneutics and blah, blah. It was a deeply great book, Anthony, if you're listening, which you're probably not, but very difficult to understand. So if you're not listening, that's okay. And he talks about, he introduces this whole idea of the hermeneutical circle and so on, which functions in different kinds of ways. But one of the ways is you're always making sense of a word in the light of the context, but the context in the light of the words. There's a sort of, and there's a constant back and forth, or spiral, you know, in understanding as you move back and forth between the parts and the whole and so on. And so, in fact, I think it's a little bit more complicated than I suggested, right? Considerably more complicated. It's not... You can't just ever have an exegesis of a particular... You can never make any sense of a particular passage without bringing to it, or, you know, for God so loved the world, right? Already you're reading that, bringing a whole bunch of stuff that you understand by what God means and the world and what love means into the text. But the text, in turn, reshapes the way you understand those things and the way you understand other texts. So, in a sense, I don't even know that I want to... Talk about priority here. Which one comes first, a chicken or an egg? It's always, you're reading, you're exegeting texts, and you're having to do justice to that text as it stands, or you're trying to, endeavoring to, but you're also trying to make sense of it in the light of this other stuff. You're trying to make sense of the other stuff in the light of these texts and so on. It's back and forth between the big picture to make sense of the parts, and the parts to make sense of the big picture. And so it's a constantly moving feast, as it were. Our theology is, and understanding is always dynamic. But it means then, I guess my point was only that sometimes people think that what they're doing... I mean, I remember I had one conversation with a guy, and it was deeply frustrating to me. It was on The Rich Man and Lazarus, which is an important text in the discussion, and I'm not entirely happy with the way I make sense of it. So I think it's a text that I... feel there's a lot more for me to understand to really get it. I don't, you know, than what I have. But for him, I mean, everything begins and ends with this text. The whole discussion. He didn't want to move anywhere outside of this text to understand the text, or to understand anything else. So no matter how many considerations you brought to bear on the discussion, from he didn't care. It had no bearing. But what? You know, you can't get around this, so I'd explain, well, what if it means this? Could it mean this? Well, it could mean this, but I don't think it does. What about you? We never got anywhere, because for him, everything began and ended with Luke 16. And I just thought, well, that's a hopeless way of trying to do justice to the whole counsel of God. We're trying to do this, and we're all stumbling along and trying. Everyone in this discussion is trying to do this. And maybe it just helps us to be more aware that we're trying to do this. And I guess... I felt the reason I took this approach of trying to paint a big picture, and in a sense, you know, you will have noticed that the big picture is actually, it didn't fall out of the sky. I mean, it comes from reading the small bits, right? So it's not that I start with a big picture. I kind of, it grew out of this spiraling process. But it felt to me like the discussions always, let's talk about hell. Okay, here's a verse of Matthew 25. This is where this discussion starts. And I think, well, it doesn't have to start there. And in some ways, if you start the discussion there, you're kind of prejudging where how it ought to go and how those texts ought to be read. Well, let's just kind of turn it around a little bit and say if we try and paint a big picture and then come and look at the text, let's hold back on those texts for a bit and then look at them. and see, might there be other ways of considering how they work? And we're more open to considering how they work if we try and look at this bigger picture. Again, it's a rambly answer. It's hopelessly inadequate. I do apologize, but I hope it makes some sense.
Thanks for one of the most gracious presentations I've ever heard, and funniest. But one of the things that came to mind was, let me see here, write it down, because I have to write it down if I'm to remember it, is this, the idea that my friend here answered it, sort of, but how do you deal with particulars if ultimately in the wash, as a universalist, God has particulars. He was sent to the widow in Sidon over those in Israel, over Naaman the Syrian, over those, the sheep and the goats. So, and speaking as a non-Calvinist, by the way, but those are important questions, I think, that come to mind, that even God has a patience, has a rubber band, has a breaking point, as shown with our father Abraham over Sodom and Gomorrah. So ultimately, he does have a breaking point, and but his breaking point's a lot longer than ours.
Yep.
And so how do you deal with that dichotomy?
With the issue of breaking points. Okay. Or the issue of particulars. I wasn't entirely sure. Did you mean?
It's kind of too prompt, but
okay.
He has a particular breaking point, and he right. definitely has preferences.
Yep, okay. So, I do think that's very important, that there are breaking points in the way God... So there are lines that God draws in the sand, and if you pass over that line, there are consequences. And there's no going back and avoiding them. And I think of this a bit like driving down the interstate. And there are various junctions that come along. And, you know, if you miss the junction, you can't just loop back and catch it. I mean, if you miss the junction, and it might be, so you've got a queue of traffic up ahead, you miss the junction to get off, there's nothing you can do to avoid the traffic. So there are consequences, and you've missed a breaking point, as it were. Doesn't mean that there's no, at some point, no subsequent opportunities to get off. It might not be for a while. And even if you miss the next one, you've missed another thing, and there's consequences for that. I think, for example, in Jeremiah, where God calls Israel to repent and repent. If you don't repent, God will send judgment, and they don't repent. And so God says through Jeremiah, it's too late. Whatever they do now, judgment from Babylon is coming. So they've crossed the line, and that's it. There's no going back. There's nothing they can do to avoid that. But then there's another breaking point. So they're in the city, and God says, okay, you've got to surrender to Babylon. If you surrender to the Babylonians, which wasn't the ideal in the first instance, they wouldn't have even come. But if you surrender to the Babylonians, you'll be okay. It'll go well with you. But if you don't, it won't. And some do, and some don't. But that's another breaking point that God put in. And there are consequences that follow. So I think... And the Gospels, Jesus' teaching, threatens judgment and warnings of judgment, and there are lines drawn in the sand, and there's very clear points at which Jesus is saying, it's too late. If you cross that line, it's too late, and there's nothing you can do to stop the consequences of that in terms of divine judgment. So I would say then, universalism has to be able to accommodate that. And it has to be able to allow that to stand as the truth. That is the way it is. What I would say, though, however, is that the big picture allows us to contextualize those breaking points as not final, not ultimate. There is no ultimate point at which God would finally terminate a creature, because that would constitute a failure on God's part. And God is able to bring it about that that creature will freely respond in the end, even if it requires that the creature goes past several breaking points and faces the consequences of so doing. I don't know if that makes any sense. And you might not find it an adequate response, but that is how I would... That's my basic strategy, and then I'd have to look at the particular texts.
Hi, thank you, Rob.
I have a question. My dad passed away 2007, and he was a tough guy, New Yorker, and I became a believer, and I always tried to talk about Jesus with him, and he would never, even up to his death, he would never give in or have anything to do with it. But I love him, and I still love him. And my question is, in regards to annihilationism, I'm a believer in the Lord, and I believe on his word that when I die, I'm going to be resurrected and brought into his kingdom. I bank on that because that's what Jesus said. But my love for my father in my heart, I don't feel could ever be negated or voided. And I couldn't imagine being in total joy without my father in God's kingdom, to be told, well, you know, your father missed the mark, and so we had to annihilate him. Or as the traditionalists say, we had to put him in some cosmic dungeon to torture him for all eternity. Either way, you're not going to have your father anymore. So some people say, well, you know, your memory of your father is going to be erased, or you'll be at a higher spiritual plane, and you'll just accept the fact that your father is not going to be with you. But I just wonder, when the scriptures say that my mercy triumphs over my judgment, and that I desire mercy, not judgment, I just wonder if you could, you know, talk about that a little bit. I would like to have my father in heaven with me, even though he never professed Christ.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think you put the issue well. And I do think it's a real and significant issue. I mean, for traditional view of hell, what we call the traditional view of hell, and for annihilation, is the problem of how the redeemed can have perfect happiness if those they love are either suffering forever or extinguished. I don't have much to add to that. I mean, I do think it's hard to see how it could be that we could have perfect happiness as the redeemed, knowing that that was the case. And there's all sorts of problems with God wiping our memories and so on. I mean, for instance, say, you know, your son or daughter or parent, whose so many of your memories are tied up with that. I mean, even it might be your memories of how you became a believer are intimately tied up with that person. If God just eradicates all memory of that person, there's huge gaps in the narrative logic of your memory, right? And you're in the new creation celebrating, you know, your redemption by the blood of the Lamb, and you can't quite piece together a coherent narrative of how it even happened. Because God's taken all the bits out, you know. So it's just problems with that. But of course, if you know God loves this person and you love them, and so you want what's best for them, and you know that it's forever thwarted, that's a problem. That how God, and how God could ever be completely satisfied with that. I mean, I don't have much to say to that other than that I think it's a significant issue. I don't think it's trivial or sentimental, and I think it's a pastorally important issue as well. I mean, when you're doing funerals, and you're doing a funeral for someone who's not a believer, I mean, strictly speaking, if you're a traditional evangelical, you know pretty well what the fate of that person is, and it's not good. So what do you say? How do you bring any comfort at all to the bereaved? Because you haven't got much to say apart from the slim hope that maybe in their last second they change their mind. Not very likely. You never know. Or there might be some post-mortem before the, you know, you might try and add various things in, but in the end you don't have much confidence that God will get his will done for that person. Whereas for me it is a consolation to know that there is solid grounds for hope for that person because of Christ is risen from the dead. I mean, in the end for me everything comes down to that. Christ is risen from the dead.
Well, let's give Robin another round of applause. So we're just going to give an opportunity for a brief presentation. We at Rethinking Hell really value the exegetical study of Scripture, and we wanted to give you an opportunity to hear about some tools with which you can do that. And so we have one of our sponsors, the Logos Bible software, that's going to give a presentation. So Cameron Dobbins, go ahead and take it away.
All right. Real good. Everybody awake and caffeinated still? All right, we're good. Well, I got to say, you guys are the most unique group of people. I don't think there's anyone.